money misused. Remember, Robbie, I don't want Dr. Gordon called away from my party Saturday night. No emergency calls. I'm relying on you to keep everybody healthy.
I'll do my best.
I hope you heard that, Alan.
I did.
How was your fishing trip?
Fine. How are you, Margaret?
You're my doctor. You tell me.
You look lovely.
Is that a medical opinion?
Personal.
It's cold out. Probably snow soon. I was shopping. 10th anniversary is tin, you know. So I had one of our wedding pictures redone as an old-fashioned tin type. David looks wonderful in a handlebar mustache. Anybody I know? By the way, Alan, why did you ask me to come in today?
I've been meaning to since last month, when you and David had your annual checkup. I thought I detected something and had to verify it. Sit down, Margaret, please.
Well, what do I have? Nothing trivial, I gather.
Not you. David.
David? Why, he's the biggest, strongest, healthiest. Go on. What is it?
Let's skip medical terms, Margaret. I didn't go fishing. I went to Boston, New York, Johns Hopkins.
Because of David?
They confirm my diagnosis.
What is it?
It's in the bloodstream, Margaret. Nothing can be done.
I'm all set. Oh. Louise, have Bill bring my car on, will you? Yeah, I'll be right down. Okay.
Here's a letter to McDougal, editor of the Edinburgh Express. Here are tickets to the festival performances. Here's a hotel confirmation and train tickets. Now, whether you like it or not, you're taking the train.
Oh, Jeff, stop acting like my grandmother. I've driven everything from camels to diesel trucks by myself, and I'm still in one piece. I'm driving.
This was all such a sound plan. Get you a job on my staff, wait until you got sick of it, and then buy a little house in the suburbs. How was I to know you'd turn out to be a gypsy? And the top reporter with a syndicated column in 43 American papers.
45.
I wanted to use this job to make you fall in love with me. Instead, you used me and you fell in love with your job.
You know why you want to marry me?
Yes.
No, you don't, but I'll tell you. Because I keep saying no.
Oh, you're so smart.
It's true. If I said yes, you'd beat it before I got to the S.
Well, then why don't you find out? Go on, say it.
I'm scared.
No, not you. You're not ever scared. Why don't you be honest? You're still in love with Steve.
How can you be in love with a memory?
Maybe you feel sorry for yourself.
Maybe. But I try not to. After all, I'm not the only woman who lost her husband in Korea.
Then what is it?
Maybe I have become a gypsy. Maybe I'm afraid to get attached again.
Or maybe you just want me to go on begging you a little longer.
Maybe. But in the meantime, I'll do a brilliant job on the Edinburgh Festival.
Oh, one of these days, Mary, you're going to wake up screaming, Jeff, marry me. I can't stand it without you another minute.
When that happens, I'll call you no matter where I am. Whew.
New dress?
Yes. A surprise for Bob. He's so attentive. He always notices what I'm wearing.
Oh, put it on. I'd love to see you in it.
You know, Vera has a wonderful husband. Cooking and everything.
Guilt. Sheer guilt. I wouldn't trust him as far as you could throw Frank Sinatra.
Come on, give me a hand, will you? I think you're mistaken.
Did you ever see him at a party? You don't dare turn your back on him. He's a human lobster.
Exaggerating. He's no different than your husband or mine.
Well, that's exactly what I mean. They're such beagles.
I can't answer for your George, but I certainly know about my Bob.
Gee, that's a beautiful dress. What do you know about Bob?
That he's more in love with me now than before we were married. And I feel the same way about him, too.
Well, take it from me. If it weren't for that ball and chain, he'd run for the train like a greyhound.
You just don't know him.
No? What do you suppose he'd do if he ever received a letter like this?
Checking my records, I find that my license as Justice of the Peace had lapsed a few days before your wedding ceremony was performed. It is therefore my sad duty to inform you that your marriage is not legal. I suggest that you apply for another license and marry again immediately. Regretting any inconvenience I may have caused you, I remain... Well, what's this all about?
Oh, I read a story about a couple that got a letter like that. And what do you suppose the husband did?
I know. He ran for the train, like a schnauzer.
Such dogs.
What are you doing with this letter?
Oh, I made a copy of it. I was going to try it out on George, but I chickened out. You could prove how brave you are, though. You were married by the same justice of the peace.
I can tell you exactly what would happen with Bob. He couldn't wait to get me to the marriage license bureau. There's Bob now.
Well, hasn't he got a key?
Sure, but that's just his little joke. He's giving the milkman time to get away. He's so jealous. You should see the searching looks he gives me when he comes in.
Hiya, honey.
Bob!
But I didn't know you were here. I mean, you usually stand there. What's she doing here?
Oh, well. You've got a Saint Bernard.
George Mance.
Anne.
I can scarcely believe it. How did you know I was here?
I didn't. I was just passing and I saw your painting in the window. Anne, you look wonderful.
Thank you.
How's it going?
Oh, marvelous. Just splendid. This is my first showing in New York. Oh, George, I'm longing to talk to you. But I can't get away now. Couldn't we get together later?
I'd love that.
I'm having some people in for cocktails and then going on to dinner after that. Please join us. I'm at the Plaza Towers.
What time shall I come?
Come early, before the others. At 6 o'clock?
Good. You know, this is the most amazing
thing. Oh, Mrs. Howard.
That's Mr. Dickens. He owns the gallery. I have to talk to him. See you at 6?
I'll be there.
Make it 5:30.
Ma'am?
Afternoon.
How do?
We just had to stop by. It's been a long time.
How's that, ma'am?
Since we lived here. Rob was born here. You lived here long?
Since the war.
Kind of a strange feeling looking at what was once yours and knowing it's all in the past.
Yeah, I guess so. Now, if you'll excuse me.
Mister, would you favor us? I'd like the boy to look inside. I'd like to look inside, too.
We'd be much obliged.
Well, all right.
You're very kind. Thank you. We're staying.
Out of the West. Dick Powell's. Same Gray Theater. Tonight's star, Joan Crawford.
I hadn't expected a brass band welcome, but there was no one to even take care of my horse. And yet I had a feeling something or someone was watching me. It was a strange home for a wealthy man. Barren, run down, desolate. And as I moved toward the front door, I had a premonition that my life would never be the same again.
From out of the West. Tonight's star, Joan Crawford.
John Baylor, isn't it?
Yes.
I heard you ride in. We don't have many visitors, but we were expecting you.
Did your father get my telegram?
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. Won't you please come in?
Thank you.
And let me see your ID. I wasn't kidding. That's where she kissed me. I said, I'm sorry, we don't serve minors. She said, I love you. That's not minor. Now, there are tears in her eyes, and that's when she went for her father.
And she's only 15?
He took me aside. He said, young man, I understand the life of a social director during the season here at Poland Springs can be fraught with all types of unique problems, of which Binky is probably the most unique.
Binky?
That's his daughter's name, the one who's chasing me. He said, don't discourage her. She needs a lesson, not an explanation.
I said, sir, your daughter is only a child. You ought to be ashamed. He said, shame is a judgmental word. See, he's an analyst.
Anyway, he said, I trust you, Stiles. You'll walk a careful line, won't you?
Had to leave it then, because Binky came rushing in and kissed me right in front of him and...
Bye.
He just stood there and smiled.
Leo, put Hershey in number one stall.
Yes, ma'am.
We were all wondering when the horses would arrive. My boys love to ride. I can guarantee you a waiting list of customers.
Your boys? You don't look old enough.
60 of them. Count them, 60. I'm next door at the caddy camp. Summer counselor. Link case.
Mm-hmm.
the gate now, Link Case.
I dropped everything the moment I heard.
No. No, don't. Not while I'm feeling so terribly guilty.
Guilty? What about?
About Simon, of course. I killed him.
What are you talking about? The newspaper said it was...
It was his heart. But I know the truth. Oh, if I only hadn't been so stupidly honest, blurting everything out.
What did you say to Simon?
Well, I told him about us, of course. About you and me. And I'll never forgive myself.
You told him what about us?
Well, at first all I said was that I wanted a divorce. There's nothing so unusual about that, is there?
I mean, what did you tell him about me?
Nothing. You know, Randolph, I don't think you've ever been aware of this, because Simon always had such beautiful manners. But he absolutely loathed you.
I'm flattered. Go on.
That's all. A few hours after we talked, he had the attack.
Yeah, excuse the intrusion, but her car broke down and we'd like to use your phone to call the automobile club.
Oh, please, it's right there. Help yourselves.
Thank you very much. Oh, boy, I'm tired. We must have hiked 10 miles.
Oh, Viv, don't exaggerate. It was only 2 miles.
It was 10 miles. I got 10 blisters to prove it.
You girls must be exhausted. I'll get you some lemonade.
Oh, please, we don't want to be any trouble.
Oh, it's no trouble. Please, just make yourselves comfortable.
Thank you.
Make ourselves comfortable?
Well, she meant well. What?
Did she look kind of familiar to you?
Come to think of it, yeah.
Here's something you can sit on and rest while I make the lemonade, okay? And it won't be long.
Thank you.
Miss Joan Crawford, Ossie Davis, Richard Kiley, Roddy McDowell, and Barry Sullivan. Starring in the Night Gallery. I'm Rod Serling. I would like to invite you to join me for the telling of three stories represented in this gallery by these paintings, to be displayed here for the first time. Each is a collector's item in its own way, not because of any special artistic quality, but because each captures on a canvas, suspends in time and space, a frozen moment in a nightmare.
My abiding concern, Doctor, and my singular preoccupation is myself. 11 hours or 12, fewer or more, it makes no difference. I want to see something. Trees, concrete, buildings, grass, airplanes, colors!
Listen,
Now you look here, old man. Death is final. Death is it.
I think not, Mr. Jeremy. I think there are things stronger than death and more lasting than the grave.
The Portafoy?
I think hate is stronger than death, Mr. Jeremy. And I think you're beginning to realize that.
Join me for the unveiling at the Night Gallery.
Some of the real people that we have here tonight. Now, you take Miss Crawford, for instance. Well, I'll tell you something. I'll tell you how you can tell this lady is real. Now, we got a little place down here where we go to cook and eat our lunch and everything, and the cook came up, and he said to Miss Crawford when she went to lunch, he said, "What do you have?" And she said, "Tuna." Well, I'll tell you, I thought the guy was going to fall down. You know, because you take a star of Miss Crawford's statue, you'd think that she'd ask for the fresh food plate, you know? No, sir, man. Went for the tuna. I thought the guy was really going to pass out. So I'd like to introduce now a person. I mean, when you think of real people, you automatically include her. So here she is. It's Joan Crawford, a real person.